My name is Michał Saniewski. I work in Institute of Meteorology and Water Management in Poland, and I will present presentation titled Anthropogenic Radioisotopes Strontium-19 and Cesium-137 in Antarctic Fauna and Flora. Strontium-19 and Cesium-137 are two most important anthropogenic radionuclides, which half-life is about 30 years. Polar ecosystem has been considered as unpolluted, but this area has been contaminated by anthropogenic radionuclides, including strontium and cesium. The main source of these isotopes were followed from atmospheric nuclear weapon testing in the 1915s and 1960s, and in the case of Arctic, also Chernobyl accident in 1986, Fukushima accident in 2011, and international discharge of radioactivity waste from an industrial plant producing and processing radioactivity material in Sellafield and Lahore. Approximately 90% of nuclear tests were conducted by the United States and Soviet Union, so the North Hemisphere is most contaminated than Southern. However, radionuclides were deposited in Antarctica after the air mass movement in the upper atmosphere and stratosphere. Over all of Antarctica, the total fallout of cesium-137 ranged from 16 becquerel per square meter to 131, and it is definitely less than in the Arctic fallout of cesium, which ranged from 390 to 2200 becquerel per square meter. Research conducted in the Svalbard archipelago region to determine cesium activity in selected species in different areas between the period 1985 to 2017 and along the transect leading from the glacier foreland showed that the activity of this element doesn't decrease with time, and in the case of sediment, it is even higher than in previous years. High cesium-137 activity in the soil suggests a natural source of this isotope, which may constitute the nearest melting glacier. Therefore, at the end of 2018, we organized an expedition to King George Island, Southern Shetland Island, for sampling and checking if in Antarctica similar process take place as in the Arctic. During the 40 days expedition, we collect samples of seawater, sediment, macrophytoventic and zooxanthic organisms by scuba diver from 16 stations. Also, we collect samples of soil, lichen, moss and vascular plant from 8 terrestrial stations. Cesium-137 activity were measured using a gamma spectrometry system with a relativity efficiency of 40%. The activity of cesium-137 in the bottom sediment was higher at the station located closer to the glacier than at station located farther from the glacier. Similarly, in the case of soil, significantly higher cesium-137 activity were observed in the soil collected in the vicinity of the glacier than at a station closer to the coastline, which may suggest that similar to Spitsbergen melting glacier may be an additional source of cesium deposited in the earlier years. But due to the lack of sediment samples collected in different years, it is difficult to determine if the activity of cesium-137 at measuring station decreases or persists at similar level. In the case of terrestrial vegetation, 16 species were collected, of which only 3 species appeared most frequently. 86 samples were analyzed, and only in 16 cases the activity in the samples were below the detection limit. In most samples, the activity was very low, at 2 becquerel in kilogram dry weight, except for two samples taken at top of an Itaro Valley in the vicinity of the glacier ecology. In the case of Marine Station, the problem with finding reference species was even greater. Despite the large diversity of species, only three species appeared most often between the stations. Out of 66 samples analyzed at the moment, more than 60% of results were below the detection limit. So the activity in the Antarctic samples are very low and much lower than in the Arctic zooxanthic, because due to very low activity and extension of the measurement time, which is currently 3 days for one sample, it's hard to draw a clear conclusion as more than half of the samples are still waiting for analysis.